Hey there. I'm Mary Wipf, and I'm an artist with the South Dakota Arts Council's Artists in Schools and Communities program. I've also spent a little bit of time every year with the Sanford Arts program there in Sioux Falls. And, well, I'm used to being with you there. This year, because of the COVID-19 pandemic, we're trying out something different, and I'm doing a virtual residency. In other words, I'm staying home, and well, there are some drawbacks to that. I think there's also some advantages and some opportunities that I don't have when I'm there in Sioux Falls with you. So I live on a homestead here in the Black Hills. And as you can see, I am surrounded by nature, so I felt like this would be a good opportunity to dive in a little bit into what inspires me. I'm going to be showing you some of my favorite techniques for making marbled paper, and also be sharing some of the things that we might do with that marbled paper. But I also plan to spend a fair bit of time showing you some of the things around me that inform my creativity and how I look at making artwork and that sort of thing. So I look forward to being with you virtually, and we'll see what happens. And so today, our adventure is with a very old process for decorating paper. It's called Suminagashi. Sumi is ink, and actually specifically black ink. And nagashi means floating. So we're going to do some ink floating. I think you'll find the process rather magical. We've got really simple ingredients, just paper and ink, and then just as important, we're going to be using air and water. It's an alchemy of sorts. We're going to be making these incredibly liquidly elegant patterns on paper. Using paper, ink, air, and water. And we're going to do it outside today. I'm reading from a book by a British author, Anne Chambers, a book called Suminagashi, The Japanese Art of Marbling. Just to give you a little bit of the history of Suminagashi. And this little portion was written by the director of the paper museum in Tokyo. Kayofusa Narita, who lived from 1884 to 1979. It is impossible for us to ascertain the exact date or by whom the process of Suminagashi was invented, or when it was made known to others by the inventor. Of this art in its early years, there is no orderly historical record. Only available now are some surviving specimens of the distant past, a few scattered notes and legends. Fortunately for a researcher, there are a number of splendid examples, either privately owned or kept as national treasures in the National Museum. One of these is Poetical Works of 36 Men, written in around 1118. In this anthology, there are at least four sheets of Suminagashi. The patterns on these sheets are quite different from those on later examples, and we find that some of them were designed with mica powder. And I'll show you a photograph of that work here. In the Heian era in Japan, an era of nearly 400 years duration, from 794 to 1185, there was one of the most illustrious periods in the history of Japan. In this era, Japanese art, sculpture, and architecture, originally influenced by Chinese culture, began to show a national tendency. In response to this new trend, Suminagashi appeared as a unique art, and because the patterns produced by a special technique were exceedingly attractive, Suminagashi was especially welcomed by those of the upper class. During the Heian era, the motifs for the Suminagashi were obtained from only two sources. One source was the flowing motion of wind-blown white cloth. The other, patterns seen in slowly running streams coursing through fields. During this period, the delicate patterns made with ink did not cover the entire sheets of paper, but were confined to a small area in the upper right corner of a page. On these special papers, short poems of 31 syllables were written. A family in the Ichizen prefecture were famous producers of Suminagashi, and this was the Hiroba family. And the papers were not generally available to the public. They were, for 400 years in fact, used exclusively by the imperial household and by the country's nobility. Well, I found a really nice little spot up here above the pond. I've got a nice flat mossy rock here. I can still hear the water down by the pond and creek. And of course the birds are singing too. So I'm gonna set up my equipment right here on this little rock. I brought a little water from the pond. So I'm not gonna talk a lot about what I'm doing. I'm just going to partake in the process, and then later in our advanced session we'll go into the details of what all this is and why it works the way it does, where it comes from, that sort of thing. I don't think I actually needed to bring my fan along. A picture of wind on water. just rinsing off a little bit of the loose zinc.
I'm going to make a few here that are extremely simple and low-key. These will be papers that I use later for other projects, perhaps drawing. And so these are intended to be, once they're dry, have another layer of color added onto them to make a even deeper, richer color. So these next couple will be kind of drab and simple, but later on perhaps you'll see the things that we can do with this sort of paper. And I am kind of rocking that paper intentionally as I lay it down. You can see that puts these little ripples in the image as it's applied to the paper. I'll do one more like that with that method. And then later on, like I said, I'll add another layer to those. So I'm going to return again to a more traditional type of pattern like you saw me do first. Now that my bath is a little bit dirty here, I'm going to go with a little more contrasty set of colors. A little more dark light contrast. A little bit of a windy day for this. That's okay. I like the challenge. Once we're inside, we won't have wind. We'll probably miss it then. you're listening to the chorus of some of my favorite birds, the Swainson's thrush. It always shows up in late spring, and by this time of the year, and we're at mid-June now, they're singing this kind of all day, but it's more early in the morning and late at night, or in the evening. And we've tried to describe the sound, and we've just kind of settled on the sound of molten glass shattering. But it's one of my favorite sounds in the whole world. And the wind has kind of died down a little bit, so now I actually have more of a use for a fan. And by the way, that bird, the Swainson's thrush, it likes the creek margins. And here we have a spruce forest. It nests in the spruce forest, and it has a territory, like a lot of birds and other animals. It doesn't need very much space, maybe about 300 feet, so when we go walking up the creek, you can hear a new one coming as you walk, and you'll have this song from these birds along with you as you travel up and down the creek. This is a, oh gosh, we've had so many woodpeckers this year. This one is a three-toed woodpecker. You see, he likes to travel down backwards on the tree. So he looks a lot like a hairy woodpecker, but you see maybe that his back is a little more gray and slightly, I don't know what you'd call it, barred in the back. And this would be a female, because the male, whoop, there she goes, the male has a little yellow patch on the top of his head.
Wonderful interaction between air and water, and how it becomes so evident with the art of Suminagashi. And the wind is picking up a little bit, and it's getting a little chilly out. I think it might be time to move inside for a look at some more advanced techniques. So this is the end of this session, and I look forward to seeing you again for another look at some of the things that we can do with ink floating on water. Thank you.